Good morning, friends. This is Reverend Margaret Hiller with Unity Myrtle Beach. My topic today continues to be our four-week study on the Lord's Prayer using the Aramaic translation. Hope you can be with us today for the message, for the wonderful music, and particularly the beautiful community of people who gather here to study spiritual insights, deepen spiritual awareness, and to sprout acts of compassion and kindness in the world. Remember, you are the light of the world.
Space, our community of unity, our unity community. Before we begin, I love to do like breathing meditation, and I picked a reading about, so there's a lot of craziness going on in the world, locally, whatever, but I believe that peace begins within us. So our inner peace, if we're at peace, hopefully we'll spread. So the affirmation that I picked is, I let the small things go and find peace. On those days, I feel quick to irritation and anger. I may mistakenly blame other people and circumstances for the lack of peace in my mind and heart. But when I remember I choose my reactions, I realize I can choose to meet any situation with peace. I give meaning to the things that happen to me and around me. I keep this in mind the next time I feel my peace disturbed. If before I might have lost my temper, I now pause to breathe deeply before I speak. If I may have been tempted to blame another in my frustration, I now see them as a fellow divine being worthy of kindness and understanding. Inner peace is always available to me. I claim this peace as my own and keep life's small irritations in perspective. And just take a nice inhale through your nose, inhaling peace. And as you exhale out of your mouth, relax, exhaling calm. Just pause for a moment. Wonderful. So, as we begin our service this morning, our next song by this lovely band, we got a lot of Unitics in the house today. The next song is Love the One You're With. Make up the words as I go, so I suggested that they know what the words are. So, as a newbie, I was in first. So, let's all. And as we say the Lord's Prayer, Reverend Margaret's talk today is still, we're still on that topic of the Lord's Prayer. So, maybe just read it, say it, feel it, all that good stuff. So, Father, Mother, Birther, breath of all. create a space beside us and fill it with your presence. Let oneness now prevail. Your one desire then flows through ours as energy fills all form. Give us this day our physical and spiritual nourishment and entangle the knots of error that bind us as we release others. Do not let appearances make us forgetful of the source, but free us to act appropriately from age to age through you, flow the glorious harmonies of life. May these words be fertile statements through which our future grows. Amen. Amen. Amen.
All right, so the daily word for today is Divine Order, Sunday, July 14th. The affirmation is, during times of uncertainty, I trust divine order. How often have I felt disappointed when something did not work out as I had planned or hoped, only to discover a blessing I had not anticipated? Understanding that a seeming obstacle may actually be an unrecognized opportunity, I resist the temptation to wonder why the setback is happening. Instead, I pray, asking, what is mine to do? I may receive guidance to wait for a better time to pursue my plan, or perhaps an insight will arise out of what appears to be failure, showing me a way forward that will accomplish even greater good. Affirming divine order keeps me patient and trusting in right outcomes in all situations. And the scripture verse is, for now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And that's 1 Corinthians 13:12. And again, we'll say that affirmation together. I'll say it one more time, and you don't have to join me. During times of uncertainty, I trust divine order.
During times of uncertainty, I trust divine order.
All right. So, now we are ready for Reverend Margaret to finish week three of the Aramaic prayer.
We have a song.
Okay. The Wayfaring Stranger will be the next song. Sorry, guys.
One, two.
I'm going back. Don't go no more.
guys are so good. Yeah. Y'all, when we used to sing that on my mom and dad's dock on the St. John's River, it didn't sound quite that. I love that we can sing an old, old gospel kind of song in our Unity Church. Anybody from anywhere, from any spiritual path can pretty much interpret that song according to their spiritual perspective, right?
Yes.
It can be old-time religion. It can be Pentecostal. It can be Buddhist. It can be Unity.
A new time religion.
A new time religion.
Whatever that is.
I could preach on it, really. Maybe we'll just skip the Lord's Prayer today and have that song. Oh, so giving thanks for your presence here today, giving thanks for this wonderful music team, and giving thanks for this place, giving thanks for the air conditioning. So we want to begin our meditation today, or continue meditation. I love the way Colleen starts us with that. You know, Jesus instructed his disciples that when they prayed, to enter into their inner chamber, to shut the door and pray in secret. So the idea, Charles Fillmore said it this way. He's our co-founder of the Unity Movement. He said, quietly enter the inner chamber within the soul. Shut the door to the external thoughts of daily life and seek conscious union with God. This is the highest form of prayer we know. So when we want to seek conscious union with God, another way to say that is union with spirit, union with the life energy moving through every cell and atom of your being, union with the creative consciousness of all the universes that we see and those that we don't yet see, union with the most powerful life energy. That's what we're praying to be in union with. So when you do the Lord's Prayer, any powerful invocation, take care with the consciousness with which you're saying the words, because to invoke that kind of presence is not for sissies. I want you to think about that. When you ask for electricity to come into your home, do you ask for just one light bulb to be lighted up? Or do you ask for all the appliances to work, all the lights to work, the air conditioning to work, or the heat to work? Do you ask for the everything to work when the electricity comes into your home? Or will one light bulb do? So when we invoke the presence, we are invoking what? The fullness of spirit. I don't think I want to say, okay, I invoke the full, well, just a little bit. I'll invoke just a little bit of that presence. I think we want to go for the full throttle. So this morning, I want to go into our meditation with the first three lines. The traditional prayer is, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We all know those lines, right? When we say them in the Aramaic, it comes out a little differently. So as we move into this time of silence, I invite you to take a few deep healing breaths, a few conscious breaths. And as we breathe, imagine your breath is the holy breath of spirit. Imagine as you breathe in, that breath, that holy breath, created all that we see and beyond what we can see. The
As we take a deep healing breath, we breathe into gratitude for the renewal, for healing, for restoration, for regeneration of body, mind, and spirit. Continue to gently and consciously breathe as we listen to the Aramaic translation of those first three lines. O birther, father, mother, who creates all that moves in light, respiration of all, radiant one, you shine within us. Our eyes and ears awaken, and heaven comes. Focus your light within us and make it useful. Let us clear forgetfulness from the space inside. We enter the Holy of Holies, our prayer closet. And through our fiery hearts and willing hands, we birth new images for a world of peace. Let our wills move together in your vortex as stars and planets swirl through the sky. Help us love beyond our ideals and sprout acts of compassion for all life. So as we go into silence, I invite you once again to ponder these ideas. That in this place, in this holy place, we birth new images for a world of peace. And we sprout acts of compassion for all life. In this place, this Holy of Holies, this chamber of awakened consciousness within us, we birth images for a world of peace, and we sprout acts of compassion for all life. Breath, breathing into gratitude for all the blessings we see and those we do not yet see. We say, so it is, and so we let it be. Namaste. I love that line, let us love beyond our ideals and sprout acts of compassion. The Aramaic language that we're told Jesus spoke invokes understanding of oneness, and the Aramaic language constantly uses images from nature and from gardening. The Aramaic prayer leads us to remember that we're standing on a living, moving, constantly creating, alive earth. And we're a part of that, and it's constantly sustaining us. And we're praying to be in union with the same life-sustaining energy that sustains the earth and all that we see. This idea of being renewed by this life energy makes sense to me because I'm often in the garden. How many gardeners do we have here? Yeah. Get dirt under your nails. For those who don't garden, we're going to start keeping a bowl of dirt by the door. So instead of holy water that you, we're going to dip our, because research shows, did you know this, that there's healthy bacteria, organisms in the soil, and you can actually be renewed. It actually is pretty wonderful to read about. Here's what studies have shown. For the people who were studied, some of the world's longest living people in the blue zones, you know about the blue zones on the planet, where people are living past 100, 105, 110, 115. Here's what they found. One thing that all these folks have in common, one of the most important, is that they get out in the fresh air, the sunshine, and they till the soil, they get dirt under their nails, they grow much of their own food. So gardening, getting dirt under your nails, reduces stress, reduces depression, and helps us feel happier. If you want to sign up for the garden teams after this, you come see me. Gardening is good for learning that when there's a problem, you deal with it, and the garden survives. Gardening offers a chance to focus on a goal and see it through. I mean, don't you get excited when you see the first zucchini, the first tomato, right? I know who you are. You jump up and down, we got a tomato! And then out in the garden, then there's the big zucchini. Healing comes by seeing things growing and thriving. It's good exercise, physically, mentally. It restores dexterity and strength, aerobic exercise, all those good things. And getting dirt under your nails, it helps us, that healthy bacteria that lives in the soil can increase levels of serotonin and reduce anxiety. Is that pretty cool?
Yeah.
Green exercise improves self-esteem and mental health. And we're more likely to eat healthy food when we're around fresh food, right? So why am I talking about gardening today? Other than the idea that I know we've got some folks who are just on the fence waiting to be a part of the gardening around here. Because it occurred to me that the Lord's Prayer is a way of tilling our own souls, tilling our own souls, doing the inner work, stirring it up, becoming aware and conscious of what we're doing with our words. So keep that in mind as we continue to explore the Lord's Prayer. It's a way of tilling the energy of your own soul. So we're invoking oneness when we do the Lord's Prayer. We're invoking that union with Creative Spirit. As a matter of fact, the writer of this book, Prayers of the Cosmos, Neil Douglas Klotz, he says, in a way, we're calling ourselves to be birthed and awake. We're asking that the creative breath, the fiery consciousness from the big heart of reality arrive in us, become alive in us. So, you know, we talk about God perspective or big perspective or universal perspective. We talk about getting the big picture, right? When I'm reduced to only seeing the world through eyes of fear, I stop seeing the big picture. Isn't that what we do? We kind of collapse into one moment of possibilities, and sometimes they're fearful possibilities, and we stop seeing the big picture. So this scholar of Aramaic says that the holy space inside of us is used as a workshop. And I want us to keep thinking about that idea. You know, we say this prayer every Sunday. And I'm always concerned for myself and all of us that we're going to say it so rotely. We're going to memorize it, and we're not going to pay attention to the words we're saying. You know, that's what happens when we say the same thing over and over, right? So I want to keep inviting awareness and to be awake when I say this prayer. So today, the lines that we're working with: give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So let's all take a deep breath, because this is the real biggie. This is the biggie. And it seems like these two operate together, receiving our physical and spiritual nourishment is hinged with, is connected with, our ability to forgive. So I'll say that again. Receiving our physical and spiritual nourishment is connected with our ability to forgive. Someone might ask, well, what does that have to do with physical nourishment? Have you ever tried to enjoy a meal when you're really angry with someone? Did it ever affect your digestion? When you're really upset with someone or some event, some circumstance, some group, some world event. So let's start with daily bread. The word bread in Aramaic is lachma, L-A-C-H-M-A. And that stands for physical nourishment. So we pray for physical nourishment. And we also pray for the bread of understanding, because the word also came to mean spiritual nourishment. So we pray every Sunday in our version of the Aramaic Lord's Prayer, give me this day my physical and spiritual nourishment. So it's food for all forms of growth, all forms of life in general. So it came from a basic root word. And this word, bread, actually further translates as growing, vigor, verdancy, warmth, passion, and possibility. All of that in the word bread. Remember when Jesus said, "This is my body"? He broke the bread. It's talking about the body of spiritual wisdom and consciousness. He wasn't actually asking us to eat flesh from his body. He was asking us to eat the knowledge and wisdom that he had brought into the world through his consciousness. Through the generations, the word for bread, lachma, in Aramaic and ancient Hebrew, morphed into the word chokhma, H-O-C-H-M-A, which is translated as holy wisdom. Give me this day holy wisdom. So we're praying for enough beans to be in the pot for tonight's dinner, but we're also praying for the spiritual, the holy spiritual wisdom to be alive in us. And then generations pass, and the Greeks morphed this word for holy wisdom into the archetype of feminine wisdom, Sophia. All of that from the word bread through the generations. So the prayer becomes this invocation that we receive what we need for our lives, our daily sustenance, but we're also praying for clarity for the next steps, clarity and understanding about this moment that we're living in. Thank you for the bread and butter, and thank you for the divine insight and holy wisdom. That's what we're praying for. So here's how this one line translates into Aramaic. When we say, give us this day our daily bread. I'm so glad for the technology we have, that we are recording and it's going on live stream, and then Dave Lacombe will put it on YouTube next week on our Unity Myrtle Beach website. So we can go back and review, because during the week I was getting emails, now what was that word you said and what did it mean? And it's also this tiny little book. I just love this little book and the people who do the research to bring us these ideas. So Prayers of the Cosmos, again, is the name of it. So this one line, give us this day our daily bread. These are just a few of the ways it's translated. Grant what we need each day in bread and insight. Give us the food we need to grow through each new day and through each illumination of our awakening. Help us fulfill what lies within the circle of our lives each day. May we feel the wisdom underneath our feet supporting us all. Generate through us the bread of life. Grant what we need each day in bread and insight. So we might ask, which is more important, physical nourishment or spiritual nourishment? Sometimes we act like the most important thing is the physical nourishment. We want to keep our bodies healthy so that we can hold holy wisdom, right? The prayer reminds us of what always stands underneath us, Mother Earth. We don't get divine sustenance. We don't get the food, the healthy food we need, unless we have the cooperation of Mother Earth, right? You know the joke, see if I can remember it. The joke where the man says, okay, God, I think I've got it figured out now. I can do all the things Jesus did in greater. I can do this. I got it. I'll take it from here. Thanks for giving me everything I need, but I'll take it from here. I'm going to start a garden. I'm going to make my own Garden of Eden. I'm going to make everything right again, because we need to make the world right again. And God says, great, go for it. What are you going to use for dirt? We can't make our own gardens unless we're using all of the blessed elements that are here already. And sometimes our species acts like we can destroy those elements and still live healthy lives. I think that's called insanity, but that might be another talk. So we pray for our daily bread, our physical sustenance and insight, and we treasure the source of the bread by not harvesting or demanding from the earth more than we need. I'll pause while we think on that. Is it really smart to demand from the earth more than we need? This prayer asks us to respect the source of our most basic support, the earth. Give us this day our physical and spiritual nourishment. And untangle the knots of error that bind us as we release others. This is a lifetime of inner work, releasing and untangling the cords of error that bind us. Or maybe that's just me, that it's been a lifetime of work. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. In Aramaic, loose the cords of mistakes binding us as we release the strands we hold of others' guilt. Have you ever held someone in your vision, has seen them as guilty, and then you hold that picture of them for, oh, I don't know, decades? Have you ever done that? Am I the only one? Yeah. Someone disappoints you, or you believe a story about someone. It may or may not be true, but you believe the story, and in your consciousness, your definition of them is they're guilty, right? So what does that have to do with us receiving our physical and spiritual nourishment? Because this prayer asks us to clear the space inside of all that holds us back so that we can receive the good that is out.
Amen.
Right? We have to clear it. So one of my stories that I like to remember because it's a huge teaching for me and David. When we hold someone as guilty in our consciousness, we were on one of our now infamous five-day canoe trips in Colorado, camping along the way and shooting rapids along the way. And Pam was with us on some of those trips. So two guys, we had a Course in Miracles guy who's a Unity minister also, Bob Woods from Denver, Colorado, and another guy from Centennial Canoe Trips, his name was Mike, is actually a professor at University of Colorado, a geologist, and he was one of the guys. So we felt like we were in good hands, and about second or third night of the trip, I got up the next morning and I went over to the kitchen area of the big camp, and I saw Mike, Dr. Mike, laying face down in the dirt.
Oh.
And at first I had a little bit of panic, oh my God. And I looked over at Bob, the other guy, and he's making the coffee, getting the scrambled eggs ready. I said, Bob, shouldn't we be concerned? Mike's face down in the dirt. Bob said, he'll be okay, just give him a minute. So I don't know what went on the night before. I don't know how long he'd been face down in the dirt, but it didn't seem to be a big problem. He got up, he brushed himself off, he started getting things ready. But David and I kind of copped an attitude, right? I know it's hard to believe because normally we're very perfect people. But we kind of copped an attitude. Okay, we've paid this money, we've gathered all these people. I mean, you know, our reputation is kind of on the line. And our guides, you know, they need to be good. And our one of our guides was face down in the dirt, and oh my God, and I just kept spinning the story. And he, because for the first 2 days, he had been pointing out the different geological features of the canyons we were going through and the river, and it was so wonderful having a geologist on the canoe trip. It was fabulous. And then suddenly, that didn't mean anything anymore because
he was.
I had seen him face down in the dirt. So I had an attitude. Anybody who is face down in the dirt can't be a good guide on a canoe trip.
What did he say?
Oh, yeah. When he finally got up and stood up and brushed himself off, he said, killer dirt, man. Killer dirt. So, fourth day, we still have our attitude. We're kind of steering clear of Mike. But that day, we set up camp and we hiked into the canyon, and Mike, Dr. Mike, led us into this kind of cave system. And I was reminded of this event last week. I went to someone's home and they had a beautiful photograph of one of these places in a cave. You've probably seen it where the water has swirled and created this beautiful sculpture on the cave wall. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, this beautiful swirling movement in the stone. It was so, it's just very moving. And we all sat quietly listening to the wind move through the cave.
Everyone just sat quietly. And then Mike, out of his backpack, pulls a violin. And he starts playing Ave Maria. And David and I looked at each other with tears in our eyes. It's like, Dr. Mike, Killer Dirt Mike, playing the violin. Ave Maria. He could have played Jethro Tull and I would have been amazed, but he played Ave Maria. And my heart just opened. What a lesson. You know, we judge one another. We judge our species. We judge ourselves. And we forget the light that we are, and we forget the light that others are. So I have to, in order to receive my physical and spiritual nourishment, this prayer invites me to clear the space inside and untangle the knots of air that bind us as we release others. I had to release Mike from this attitude of judgment, right? I have to often release myself from an attitude of judgment, don't you? Clear the space inside. And it doesn't seem like it's something we can do, I don't know, once a decade and we're good to go. It seems like a daily thing. So here's the words of Unloose. This is, forgive us our debts as we forgive others. Just going to read a few lines. Again, loose the cords of mistakes binding us as we release the strands we hold of others' guilt. Forgive our hidden past, the secret shames, as we consistently forgive what others hide. Lighten our load of secret debts as we relieve others of their need to repay. Erase the inner marks our failures make, just as we scrub our hearts of others' faults. I mean, how many of us carry in our hearts the stories of what others did or didn't do that we're unhappy about? Just keeping up with my own is a full-time job. I don't need to be carrying what I think others should have done or not done, right?
Right.
It's not my job. I've had to learn through the years what is my job and what is not my job. Some of you are shaking your head.
Yeah.
It's not my job to hold the cords of others' guilt. Absorb our frustrated hopes and dreams as we embrace those of others. Untangle the knots within so that we can mend our hearts. So that we can mend our hearts. That's what this prayer is asking us to do. To mend our hearts. Mike is just one story. You've all got your stories of people that you have set free into your heart of forgiveness, right? You have set yourself free and them free by untangling those knots of error. Do we know how to do that? One of the ways we do that is to know ourselves as the light of God and know each other as the light of God. And if you see me doing something silly or stupid, you can come and say, I love you so much, and you might want to consider doing that a little differently, dear. That we're here to support and encourage one another, right? Are we not?
Yes.
We know how to repair the knots that entangle us. We know how to do it. So years ago in Santa Barbara, I was a member of a black gospel choir. Really? How did that happen? There were five white people in that choir who had been rhythm and blues singers. Mama Pat was African American rhythm and blues singer. We were all white except for two or three African Americans in that choir, but it was called a Black Gospel Choir. Mama Pat had been, she sang with a lot of well-known people through the years. So she became a kind of mentor, a kind of spiritual symbol for me, Mama Pat Patrick. And I had a dream about her at one point. You know, we dream with symbols, and often we'll dream about people who represent something for us, right? So Mama Pat represented a healing presence for me. And in this dream, I was still working through the tangled knots with my former husband. Any of you know about tangled knots with former spouses? And so I was still untangling those knots. And in this dream, I saw my former husband under the water, and his shirt was torn to shreds. And I noticed that he was, I thought he was dead in the water. And in my consciousness at that time, I would not have been upset. And so Mama Pat comes to me in the dream and she said, "Can you repair this?" I said, "Well, I know how to sew." "Well, can you repair this?" His shirt was in shreds. And apparently I needed to pull him up out of the water and repair his shirt. I mean, can he do anything on his own? So, can you repair this? And she kept asking me this, and I kept telling her, "Well, I know how to sew." And she kept saying, "Well, can you repair this?" Now, here's the deal. Whatever we carry in our hearts that's keeping that holy space within us unclear, we have to do that work. We have to do that work. And we have to make the choice to do the work. So there's a difference. Can you repair it? And will you repair it? Sure, I know how to repair it. Will you repair it? So the question in the dream shifted to, will you repair it? In the dream, I had to arrive at the answer yes, because if I know how to repair it, then it becomes, am I willing to repair it? Will I repair it? You and I know how to repair the tangled up energies that are happening in the world. You and I know how to repair the knots that bind us. And it's going to be a nonstop job as far as I can tell. In the dream, I repaired the shirt. In the dream, my former husband came up out of the water. In the dream, I untangled the knots of air that bound me. And then I knew what my work was when waking from the dream. Still had inner workshop stuff to do. In mystical Hebrew, there's an idea called tikkun olam. Tikkun olam, T-I-K-K-U-N, O-L-A-M, tikkun olam. It means to repair the broken shards of light. To repair broken shards of light. In my perspective, we are all called to be the repairing people of the broken shards of light. You and I sometimes are broken shards of light. We're the light of the world, and yet we're broken as the light of the world. Our species, designed to be the light of the world, appears to be broken in many ways. Who are the ones that repair the broken shards of light? In my perspective, it's all of us. This prayer is one way we invoke that intention. Help me to untangle the knots of error that bind us. Help me to not let appearances make me forgetful of the source. I'm invoking this repairing consciousness. Do you know how to repair this? the world is broken? Do we know how to repair the broken shards of light?
Yes.
Thank you. Do we always remember? No. Will we always do it? No. Can we do it?
Yes. Yes.
You can call it doing all the things Jesus did and greater. That's one of the things he had the audacity to say. So I'm going to be busy where I'm going. You need to remember how to do this. Be a repairer of light. So I want to end my talk today by feeling very deeply this strengthening, supporting energy that we stand on right now, Mother Earth. This wonderful, incredible planet that keeps recycling, restoring, renewing, repurposing over and over and over again. We were talking about it in book group the other day about the documentary Fantastic Fungi. And the idea that everything appears to die and then it morphs into another form, and the earth is constantly renewing and restoring and reusing life energy. It can't be destroyed, only transformed to a new form. So I want us to remember this blessing, this earth blessing, and what we receive in terms of renewing energy all the time. Whether we're getting dirt under our nails, or giving thanks for the oxygen, giving thanks for the trees, giving thanks for the greening energy of spirit. So I want to end with something that I got from the Church of Facebook. And Carol DeLude posted this on Facebook. And it's called The Wisdom from the Trees. And it's a little formula that reminds us of how precious we are and that we can stand tall like the trees. You want to hear it?
Yes.
Yeah. Wisdom from the trees. Number one, stand tall and be proud. Stay grounded. Remember your roots. Be content with your natural beauty. Drink plenty of water. Enjoy the view. Be present and breathe. Isn't that great? Stand tall and proud. Stay grounded. Remember your roots. Be content with your natural beauty. Drink plenty of water. Enjoy the view. Be present and breathe. Now, in doing all of that, I invite you to consider that that's a part of repairing the broken shards of light. If you're strong, you're going to be a greater spiritual presence for me when I need to feel your strength, and vice versa. If I'm strong, then you're going to feel a greater spiritual presence from me when you need it, right?
Yes.
Because we're constantly doing this regenerative dance together, especially when we're in community. Any community you're a part of, there's a constant regenerating, restorative energy that happens from the support of one another. That's the good news. So let's take a deep breath. We give thanks for being willing to repair and to restore and to untangle the knots of error that bind us. We give thanks that we are able to create a space within for this holy wisdom to live. We give thanks that we can receive our physical and spiritual nourishment, daily nourishment for the body, and daily insight and clarity for next right steps. We give thanks to remember that we can repair the brokenness of the world, of our thoughts, of our feelings about what's going on. We can truly practice Tikkun Olam to repair the broken shards of light. This is who we are, and this is why we've come, to be a part of this repairing, regenerative energy. And we say, so it is, and so we let it be. Whew. Namaste. Namaste. Oh. All righty, now I'm going to change hats. Kate was supposed to be here as platform assistant today, and she needed to take care of her health, and so she'll be back with us next Sunday. But I'm going to take it over from here. Thank you, Colleen, for stepping in. So guess what time of the service it is now?
Announcements.
No, before announcements, we're going to give you a chance to give your tithes and donations and your green energy. The announcements, though, are as important. You know, one time at the old church, we got through the entire service and everybody was saying goodbye, and then somebody said, did we take the offering today? No. That's not good for a church. So what does it mean when you give your tithes and donations? By the way, some of you know this, some of you may not, that from the income that comes into this church, we send back out 5% to charitable organizations in the community, and also Unity Worldwide and our sub-region. So every month we have two or three recipients of 5% of our income. And if you ever have an idea of a group that you would like to see our church donation go to, please speak to one of your board members. Your board members are listed on the month at a glance, on the back table, the July month at a glance, and so you can give your idea to them. So also, your tithes and donations go to help pay electric bills, because when we call Santee Cooper and we say, we're going to hold you in prayer, and we'll trust that all is well with you, and they'll say, fine, and is your check in the mail. It pays salaries, it pays for repairs to the lawnmower, it pays for, what else, y'all? Toilet paper and paper goods for potluck. It pays for
copier
paper and the copier.
Electricity in the barn.
What?
Electricity
in the barn. Last week we got a generous donation for our building fund. And we also appreciate the generous donations that come in for general fund. And I love the generosity of this community, and I personally am grateful I get to give my every 2 weeks tithe to this church community. So we want to bless the givers, bless the tithes and donations, bless the green energy, bless the board, and the growth and development team as we decide the next right and perfect steps and how to use this green energy. We give thanks for all the ways divine flow works. As we give, we open our hearts and lives to receive, and we give thanks. So it is, so we let it be. Namaste. And we're gonna have a song now, and it's one of my favorites. Oh, happy day.
Thank you.
comes to this community, green energy, volunteer energy, we give thanks. And we give thanks for your prayers, holding your board and minister in prayer that we have the wisdom to know the right and perfect way to use these tithes. So it is, and so we let it be. Namaste. Yay. Okay, now we can say yay announcements.
Yay. Yay.
So welcome to everybody and anyone here for the first time. Some of you have been traveling so much, it feels like the first time. Welcome back. Anybody? And no new people today? All right. Yes? No? Okay.
Right here.
First time, yes. Stand up and tell us your name and where you're visiting from, please. And your blood type and your social security
number.
My name is Lee, and I live in Myrtle.
Welcome!
Okay, we're going to do connect the dots right after service. We'll set up our chairs over here near that air conditioner. And I think it's cool enough in here, right?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So it's about 30, 40 more minutes of continuing to talk about today's message. So we'll meet over here in a circle after service. The prayer box is on the back table. For your prayer request, the July schedule is also on the back table. You know, we have our Wednesday book group here. We're meeting in the back room, and Wednesday evening metaphysics with Marilyn Maddox, Reverend Marilyn Maddox. She's doing the book Soul Mastery by Unity Minister Reverend Tony Bain. Thursday afternoon, we have John Wilder doing A Course in Miracles, 11 to 12:30. And Thursday afternoon, 1 to 2:30, is Focus on Fillmore with Shirley Shear. You have anything to add, Shirley? No?
No, been great.
It's been great.
It's important to show up.
Okay. Next Sunday, our speaker for the first time will be our own Kate Richter, who is studying to be a licensed Unity teacher. She'll be our speaker. And her topic is, we are all metaphysicians. And I think that's it. Except for, I'll give you a heads up, mark your calendars. Friday night, August 23rd, Dave Lacombe and Bobby Shropshire are going to do one of their wonderful medicine shows for us right here. So that's August 23rd. All right, y'all. We're going to close with our updated prayer of unity. It is on your prayer card. You'll find it around your seats. It's inspired by James Dillard Freeman, poet laureate of the whole Unity movement. So together, please, the light of God surrounds us. The presence of love enfolds us. The power of peace protects us. And the one presence that lives within all creation enlivens us. Wherever we are, love is. Peace is, light is, God is, and all is.